People have always been fascinated by legends and epic tales of battles with terrifying monsters and incredible beasts. Fairy tales abound with astonishing creatures like mermaids, centaurs, unicorns, flying dragons, and vampires. Is it possible that these stories might have been based on actual observations? Rifle in hand, Tim Meisner advanced nervously. All around them, the forest was silent, and that was what worried him. 2 days earlier, he had seen a monster that was nearly 3 meters tall walking on the opposite bank of the lake. The monster was only visible for a few seconds, then it disappeared into the forest. Returning to the site where he had seen the creature, young Meisner was determined to flush it out. Suddenly, there it was before him, standing still. And it didn't appear to be hostile. He raised his rifle to his shoulder and took aim. Staring at the other end of the barrel, the creature did not flinch. Literature abounds with incredible tales of fabulous and extraordinary beings.
Fantastic. Extraordinary.
Monsters from an unreal world. But are they really?
Vraiment.
In the world of strange and inexplicable phenomena, it is surprising to discover that there is a branch dedicated to zoology. However, this branch of science also has its UFOs, commonly referred to as cryptids, and the study of these animals is called cryptozoology.
Alors, la cryptozoologie, sa définition, c'est,
By definition, cryptozoology is the science of unknown animals.
Science des animaux. Et donc la cryptozoologie,
cryptozoology deals with animals that have been officially recognized by science, but appear to have been seen repeatedly, here and there, all around the world, by a lot of people, who sometimes have fascinating proof.
Par beaucoup de gens, et avec des fois des preuves quand même vraiment intéressantes.
Bernard Heuvelmans.
Bernard Heuvelmans, a French naturalist and famous primatologists from the 20th century, first coined the phrase cryptozoology.
La cryptozoologie.
Without a doubt, in my opinion, the greatest name in cryptozoology is the late Dr. Bernard Heuvelmans, who was a French professor of Belgian ancestry born in Le Havre. He was the man who brought to the forefront the science of studying animals as yet unclassified by science.
Toward the end of the 1950s, the term was used for the first time to designate this branch, which actually existed long before, since there have always been individuals interested in mysterious animals. But they were dealing with something that had no name as a branch of zoology.
He had the courage, the audacity, the drive to investigate animals that a lot of scientists did not feel had any merit to be investigated. As a consequence of his actions, Bernard Hoovermans started a fire that burns brightly today. That is the fire of cryptozoology, the study and the pursuit of animals as yet classified by science.
Cryptids include such beasts as the tatzelwurm, a type of salamander that reportedly lives in the Swiss Alps, the ansa, a wild cat from Mexico, and the giant anaconda of the Amazon, which strikes fear in the heart of local natives. Cryptozoology is also the study of animals that were believed to be long extinct, but for which specimens continue to be seen now and then, like the Tasmanian tiger.
The Tasmanian tiger was an animal that was found in Tasmania, the largest island south of Australia. It's marsupial, and although it's referred to as a tiger, it's actually a wolf.
When colonists first arrived in Australia and on the island of Tasmania, the Tasmanian tiger had no natural enemy. Soon it began to attack herds of sheep. To put an end to this slaughter, the Australian government offered a reward to anyone who killed an adult Tasmanian tiger.
In 1936,
the last Tasmanian tiger died at the Hobart Zoo. The species was killed off by settlers who were fed up with the Tasmanian tigers eating their sheep. This is a good example of where the extinction of an animal is entirely attributable to humans.
So in 1936, the Tasmanian tiger joined the ranks of the cryptids. But since its extinction, several witnesses have sworn that they have seen a Tasmanian tiger in the flesh. Could it have been a different animal?
Over the years, people have reported seeing this creature that we knew was extinct and had been wiped off the face of the earth, quite literally, by hunting. But they've started to resurface all over the place, not just on the island of Tasmania, but particularly in Queensland and Australia. This has certainly generated huge interest in the cryptozoological community, because this would be classified once again as a Lazarus-type creature. It was dead and it has now come back to life. Numerous photographs have been taken of an animal by different people, which appears to be a Tasmanian tiger or a thylacine. But so far, we haven't been able to obtain a specimen. I feel from what I've seen so far and the paw prints in the ground that people have photographed, that this animal may yet still be alive. And that would be a great discovery for not only cryptozoology, but for zoology.
The northeast region of North America also has its own cryptid. The eastern cougar has officially been extinct for close to 80 years.
The eastern cougar was hunted by humans because it was slaughtering cattle. In 1938, it was realized that this was the last cougar. It was seen on the border between Quebec and Maine, and after that, there was never any further proof of the existence of the eastern cougar.
Every year, from New England to Quebec, witnesses claim that they have seen cougars. In May of 1992, a man from Abitibi even killed one of these prowlers near his van.
A cougar was killed in Abitibi by a local resident who felt threatened. The carcass was examined, and it was determined genetically and morphologically that it was not an eastern cougar, but rather a cougar originating from South America.
In the case of the Dazed Meloise cougar, analyses performed by biologists with the Quebec Ministry of Environment after the animal was killed clearly showed that it was a South American species. Obviously, the question is how a cougar from South America could have been found in Quebec, particularly in the Abitibi area. When the animal was killed, experts quickly noticed that the animal had been weak and appeared to have been suffering from dietary deficiency. The first theory put forth was that it was an animal that had been held in captivity for a certain length of time, then released into the wild, which would explain why it was so thin, because it was poorly taken care of and not used to our environment, so it had trouble adapting. The second theory is that the animal jumped onto a transport truck or into a container on a boat and ended up going the distance. This second theory was put in the report, although it's not the one that is generally preferred. Naturally, there is more of a tendency to believe that it was an animal held in captivity.
It's hard to explain how this type of cougar came to be in Quebec, but that doesn't exclude the possibility that eastern cougars may still haunt our forests.
Teams of scientists set up rubbing posts at locations where there had been the most sightings. A rubbing post would be covered in a scent that would attract the cougar. And once at the post, the cougar would rub up against it. Hair samples were gathered from the posts, like this one shown here, and then they would send them into a lab. The animal's DNA would be extracted from the hair. With these hairs from the lab, we discovered they were from a cougar. But the subspecies of the cougar has yet to be determined.
So in actual fact, it has never been proven that the eastern cougar has reappeared. But the cougar pales in comparison to cryptozoological superstars like Nessie, the famous Loch Ness monster, or the Sasquatch, the abominable woodsman of North America. These creatures are so popular that they totally eclipse all of the other cryptids. Young Tim Meisner had never heard of cryptozoology, but his story was on the verge of becoming part of it. As he had the great creature in sight, he pulled the trigger. A few feet away, the creature fell to its knees, got up, and ran away. Tim Meisner just sat there, transfixed. He would never forget his encounter with the standard bearer of Canadian cryptozoology, the legendary Sasquatch. Of all the land-dwelling cryptids, none has raised as much passion as the Sasquatch. This 3-meter-tall monster has reportedly been seen throughout all of North America.
In the 1920s, an American living here in British Columbia, an educator by the name of John W. Burns, came across stories of a creature that the native people described as sort of like a hair-covered man. They looked at it as a First Nations group of people who were different from everybody else because of their size and hirsuteness. And Burns came up with the word Sasquatch to describe this animal, which in a mixture of dialects it would mean wild, hairy man. And Burns was a very methodical gentleman. He interviewed numerous people in regard to this creature. And today, south of the border, the Sasquatch is known as Bigfoot for obvious reasons. It has huge feet and big head, big shoulder, everything. I don't know why they call it big feet, but that's simply because they found the tracks and gave it that name. But here in BC, we continue to use this name Sasquatch. It's an iconic part of our culture in British Columbia. Just about everybody knows or has heard of a Sasquatch, and many people here feel it is part of our flora and fauna.
People have been trying to uncover the Sasquatch since the 1950s. In 1961, Texas millionaire Tom Slick even funded a Sasquatch hunt in the forests of British Columbia in the hopes of discovering the elusive hominid. They were unsuccessful. Research funding was cut off when he died prematurely in 1962. With no benefactor for the past 40 years, documentation on the Sasquatch has only been collected by private investigators fascinated with this zoological mystery.
I think if Tom Slick had not died in a mid-air plane explosion back in, I think it was 1962, cryptozoology would be way further on than it is, because this man was personally the greatest benefactor to cryptozoological research there ever was.
Conk concrete evidence that the Sasquatch really exists has up until now been weak and highly controversial. This evidence falls into three categories. There is physical proof, such as footprints, hairs, and excrement, visual proof, photographs and film taken of the Sasquatch, and audio proof, noises of an unknown animal recorded in the forest. Could these be the howls of the Sasquatch? Once he got over his shock, young Tim Meisner walked over to the tree where the creature had stood. Although he was convinced that he had shot the creature between the eyes, he didn't see a trace of blood on the ground. What he did see were giant footprints. Even today, footprints remain the most convincing proof that the Sasquatch exists.
Because the Sasquatch has left tracks, these remain and are available for scrutiny for certainly days, sometimes weeks, which makes them more persistent than just a sighting.
The skeptics' arguments that all these footprints are merely a hoax cannot be accepted. Giant footprints were reported as early as 1811 by explorer David Thompson near Jasper, Alberta.
Hoaxes have been embraced by some parts of the mass media, embraced by the public, in the absence of informed comment from wildlife biologists and other zoologists. There may have been a few hoaxes, and because this seems to be so attractive and been so uncritically accepted, hoaxes have been widely accepted as explaining all tracks. But again, tracks have been recorded for 150 years throughout most parts of North America, including some very remote areas. And some people talk about conspiracy theory with regard to the Sasquatch, and I don't even like that word. But if there's any kind of conspiracy, it's the thought that there's been a conspiracy of hoaxing that widespread, that longstanding, by that many people, well outfitted and presumably well motivated.
In June of 2001, footprints were found in Pewinuk on the southern tip of Hudson's Bay in Ontario. They were discovered by Rick Tapley, an officer with the Ontario Ministry of Natural Resources, as he was inspecting weather stations. To him, it was out of the question that these might be a hoax. Since the 19th century, footprints such as those found in Pewinuk have been seen thousands of times.
Documenting tracks is also very important, either photographically, but especially if someone makes a plaster cast. Then we end up with a three-dimensional representation of the bottom of the foot that made that track. And then, once we have a collection, as we now do at Idaho State University, we can now start examining them for consistencies, irregularities, variability, that sort of thing.
Some casts show distinctive ridges in the skin along the feet and toes, anatomical features that would be difficult to reproduce.
When we talk about ridges that are found on casts of supposed Sasquatch footprints, we need to understand something fundamental. If we look at our hands, we can see the outlines of our fingerprints. Likewise, we have individual toe prints. So when researchers studied the surface of casts made from Sasquatch footprints, they noticed that toe prints were visible in some cases. The fact that they found the toe prints means that the footprints must have been made by a living animal. Because if footprints had been made by, say, a wooden foot, or something similar, like one made of latex, for example, as some skeptics have suggested, it would be very difficult to reproduce this tray, which is very precise and individual for every primate.
If it was a hoax, it had to be done by someone who really knew his stuff. If we look at a three-dimensional cast of a footprint, we can see the traces of the bones, which you would normally see on a flat foot, which is characteristic of primates. On this cast, for instance, we can see the exact location of the metacarpal and phalanx bones on this foot.
Well, this is an interesting cast, mainly because it's so small, obviously of a very young Sasquatch, and it emphasizes the breadth of the track. It's a very broad foot, much broader than a human foot would be at that size. We can also see spread toes, and there's a tendency for this one And in another young track, for the big toe to be abducted, that is divergent. In this one, it's off to the side here a bit. And in this one, very much off to the side. This is very ape-like, for the idea of the big toe diverging off to the side like that. So that's quite interesting.
As for the other forms of physical proof, the data is poor. Hairs and excrement have been discovered over the years, but it has proven impossible to identify them. That is, when they didn't turn out to be something else. In 2005, Yukon residents found hairs stuck to a fence. Witnesses claim that these hairs belonged to a Sasquatch. The hairs were sent to the University of Manitoba, where DNA tests revealed that the hairs belonged to a buffalo and not some unknown type of animal.
Dr. Henna Fahrenbach, who lives in Portland, Oregon, has a collection of hair that doesn't fall into that category. It doesn't fit into the realm of known animals, but it certainly fits into the area of unknown primates. If you asked me to say that these were definitively Sasquatch Bigfoot hairs, I couldn't say that because we don't have anything to compare them to. But they certainly don't fit into the realm of anything we know. They're not like gorilla hair, chimpanzee hair, or human hair. What are they? I think we could say safely that these are perhaps Sasquatch hairs. This is the physical evidence that we have so far.
Every year, the North American press reports a half dozen Sasquatch sightings. Cryptozoologists estimate that this number should be multiplied by 10 to give the real number of sightings per year.
There's a more of a perceived problem with eyewitness accounts, I think, than an actual problem. The perception is that these people might be hallucinating, that they might have been imagining things. And my biologist colleagues are always insisting that people are misidentifying a bear on its hind legs for a Sasquatch. So we have to look quite closely at the eyewitness. Without intimidating them, we need to be sure that they are familiar with bears and other common North American mammals, that they, you know, weren't drinking or smoking something or maybe sufficiently stressed to be hallucinating. And, you know, without being denigrating and just assuring that it's a valid observation, we can take these as an initial description to work from. Obviously, it needs to be corroborated, and that's where tracks come in. But I think eyewitness reports are really quite important and need to be considered more seriously.
Of all the animals that make up North America's wildlife, the grizzly bear is the only animal that could possibly be mistaken for a Sasquatch. So when biologists play with witnesses, they play a game of association, where they show the witness a book on North American wildlife and ask them to pick out which animal looks closest to what they saw. 9 times out of 10, the witness will pick a bear. This is basically an exercise in futility, since books on North American zoology do not contain any photographs or drawings of a Sasquatch. So the witness is not given the possibility, the alternative, of choosing something other than a bear. And as long as witnesses are not given the opportunity to choose an animal that just might be closer to what they actually saw, we can say that what appears to be similar is not necessarily so.
What's odd is that although there have been numerous eyewitness accounts, there are very few photos or films of the mysterious creature. One such rare film is considered to be key evidence that the beast exists.
One of the great characters of the Sasquatch world, without a doubt, and to whom we owe a great debt, is Roger Patterson. Roger Patterson is a man who certainly chose to live his life as he pleased, in a sense that he just simply followed his heart and did many, many things, and sometimes quite carelessly, and that gave him a bad reputation. But he wasn't a mean, malicious, crooked man by any stroke of the imagination. But he was definitely a dyed-in-the-wool and a very determined Sasquatch investigator. And he recruited a very down-to-earth gentleman who I know quite well called Bob Gimlin. And the two of them in October 1967 decided to investigate the occurrence of tracks that John Green and René de Hinden had examined in the Bluff Creek area of California. These particular footprints were quite amazing, and there were many of them.
On October 20th, 1967, Roger Patterson and Bob Gimlin were riding along a dry creek bed when Patterson noticed a creature walking away from them. He grabbed a 16mm camera and lined up behind the creature. For close to a minute, he took the most incredible footage in the history of cryptozoology. As they say, a picture is worth a thousand words.
Oh my God, it's amazing.
Patterson's film was closely scrutinized, and according to scientists, it contains details relating to the creature's anatomy and unusual walk that prove it couldn't be a hoax. If the images shown are real, then the existence of the Sasquatch has finally been proven. But are they real?
My personal opinion in regards to the Patterson-Gimlin film is it is genuine. Every person who has purported to be the man in the suit, and there are a number of them, has failed in some aspect of their story, either location, time, date, how to get there, or whatever. And their stories just don't gel, including the most recent one of a few years ago. I certainly discount that one.
Attempts were made to prove that the costume had been fabricated by John Chambers, costume designer for Planet of the Apes. This rumor was debunked by Chambers himself.
When you look at the film, it has some incredible features in regard to this creature's locomotion. A, it doesn't walk like a human being. It covers an awful lot of ground and has very large strides. And Patterson and Gimlin actually measured them in between the foot castings. A human being walking like that would be extremely awkward, and they have to be absolutely phenomenal. Donskoy, the great Russian scientist who was involved in the training of the Olympic athletes and analyzing their movements, certainly felt it wasn't a human being.
That is not a human in a fursuit. That is not a human-like gait, or even simply a modified human gait. There are some very definite anatomical features in that film. You know, the crested head, which comes up in many Sasquatch reports, is very gorilla-like. The long arms. The gate itself, but people don't want to hear that. People now have a mindset, and it's quite well entrenched that that's a hoax. And so I've gotten tired of fighting, addressing that subject, just because there's more important stuff that I think is maybe, more important.
Janusz Prochaska, who's one of the greatest costumers, said that if this was a costume, it would have to be individual hairs glued to the naked skin of a man for you to be able to see the muscle movement like that. If it was a costume, Roger Patterson would have had to make muscles move. This was in 1967 when John Chambers, the guy who did the Planet of the Apes series, and the people who did the ape-like human costumes of 2001 Space Odyssey couldn't get muscles to move. Patterson would have had to be the greatest mechanical costume genius in history, and he wasn't.
Roger Patterson died in 1972 at the age of 39. If he had stashed away the ape costume in his attic, it was never used again. Not by him or anyone else. Since the Bluff Creek incident, no one has ever produced a film as spectacular as the one taken by Roger Patterson in 1967.
Almost every year, another piece of film footage comes forward, usually video footage, often not a very good quality, showing a creature which could be a bipedal, hair-covered, dark at least, creature, which could be a Sasquatch or not. Most, I would say all of these films, none of these films, is as good as the Patterson-Gimlin film. So if the Patterson-Gimlin film is controversial or discredited, I don't think these other films are worth bringing forward.
There have also been audio tapes made of the Sasquatch. An analysis of the tapes did not prove beyond a shadow of a doubt that the howls were made by an unknown animal species.
I would say that since the 1960s, Sasquatch enthusiasts have been going into the woods to collect information here, there, and everywhere. They have come up with a dozen or so recordings of strange animal noises that some claim are made by a Sasquatch. The problem with these recordings is that none of them were obtained with a visual contact. In other words, the person holding the microphone did not see the animal making the noise. They were in the forest, heard a noise, recorded it, then sent the tape to some experts. Of the tapes submitted to zoologists, in most cases the experts were able to identify the animal that had made the noise. As for the others, which the experts were unable to identify, the voices on the tapes were submitted to a series of tests using all sorts of computers and special equipment like that used by the FBI, for example, when they want to identify a suspect that has phoned the authorities. So by performing these voice analysis tests, experts were able to determine, in some cases, that the voice that was recorded was not that of a human, was not produced by a human larynx, and they were not able to find an animal that made a similar noise. But once again, the problem is the lack of visual contact between the person recording the noise and the animal being observed. Perhaps an exception to this would be the Sierra Mountain recording, which is an exceptional recording, and where the witness who taped the noise had visual contact with the animal prior to the recording. So we can reasonably assume that the sounds on the recording are those of a Sasquatch.
Footprints, hairs, and controversial images. These are fundamentally what's being put forth to prove the existence of the Sasquatch. A flimsy case indeed. If such creatures do exist, there must be enough of them to reproduce and maintain a viable population.
The possibility that the Sasquatch may exist is intriguing. It's fascinating from a scientific perspective. And I know that there are people studying them. My only question is, if the Sasquatch does exist, then why haven't we been able to retrieve any bodies?
One of the most difficult things to explain is, after all this time, why hard physical evidence has not been found. And what we mean by hard physical evidence, and what the scientific community means by hard physical evidence, is a body or piece of the body or skeletal remains. Hard physical evidence. And the best explanation for that, I can, in my opinion, is the Sasquatch, if it exists, it's a rare, reclusive, mainly nocturnal creature, maybe one for any hunted bear in any given area.
How much more an intelligent creature that might be something like us, in the form of Sasquatch, which may go to die in places far from human attention, and also in areas that have all of the other factors like the scavenger, the acidic soil, and the insects. I'm not surprised we don't find the bones, because if we don't find cougar ones and we don't find bear ones, why would we find a Sasquatch one?
As for bones, those of the Sasquatch or its ancestors may lie at the Chinese Museum of Natural History in Beijing, where they are being carefully preserved. Among the hominid fossils is one that is surprisingly similar to the Sasquatch.
In my opinion, it would most likely be a Gigantopithecus, which is a type of primate that is quite tall, taller than a gorilla, maybe a third taller, and which possesses most of the same characteristics. Unfortunately, we don't know much about that primate. All we have to go on is a few fragmented fossils. It appeared about 2 million years ago and continued as a species for up until about 100,000 years ago, according to the fossils. So it was around during the Third Ice Age of the Cenozoic period. It was only found in two locations in the world, in China and India. So there were no specimens found in North America. Like I said, the fossils found were fragmented, and what we've been able to piece together is that it was a very tall animal, taller than a gorilla.
Is the Sasquatch the last surviving lineage of the Gigantopithecus? If irrefutable proof could be shown that it does exist, without a doubt, this would be the greatest anthropological discovery of all time.
Here in North America, Dr. Grover Krantz, who is now deceased, but used to be with the University of Washington, was a staunch defender of the theory that the Sasquatch is a Gianthopithecus. In Krantz's opinion, this was quite clear from the fossils that were found in places like China, for example. Krantz thought that the most likely theory was that during the last ice age, when the Bering Strait was completely frozen, like an icy bridge, the animal migrated from Asia to North America by crossing the Bering Strait. Then it spread out along the western coast of North America. The only problem with this theory is that, up until now, there have only been sightings of the Sasquatch. No Gianthopithecus fossils have ever been found in North America.
Over the years, cryptozoology has come to include new cryptids that some purists consider do not belong in that group. Creatures so out there that it's hard to believe that they could possibly belong to the animal kingdom. In his extraordinary encyclopedia of cryptozoology, author Michael Newton mentions a few of these creatures, such as the Mothman.
Mothman was a creature that appeared in West Virginia in the 1960s. It appeared at night, like a huge shadow. It looked like a big bat with glowing red eyes and was seen by many witnesses near Point Pleasant.
The Mothman was close to 2 meters tall with a pair of bat-like wings. He could fly straight up without beating his wings. Hundreds of sightings of the creature were reported in 1966 and 1967. Then, on December 15th, 1967, Silver Bridge, which crosses the Ohio River, collapsed, taking down with it 46 cars and dozens of motorcycles. It was later discovered that many of the witnesses who had seen Mothman were on Silver Bridge and died when it collapsed.
It appeared to be a flying creature, but what it really was, we still don't know. It had a bit of a ghost-like aspect to it, and was very terrifying, according to those who saw it.
According to native legends of eastern North America, a strange creature lives in our forests, the Wendigo.
The Wendigo is described as a mythical creature, but it's also reported to have a body. It seems to be known primarily by the Algonquin family of tribes, like the Cree, Innu, Ojibwe, and Atikamek.
The Wendigo is supposedly a giant who is capable of making himself invisible. To camouflage himself, he smears his body with resin, then rolls in the dirt to give the appearance of a giant stone. This forest spirit is also said to be cannibalistic, with a thunder-like voice.
The Wendigo seems to appear when a person is alone and isolated. In winter, in hunting camps, for example, far from the home community, from the village, in very remote areas. So it's basically a monster or a frightening creature, like many other spirits of native legend. But in folklore, it's the only one able to possess humans and, according to some, even change them into clones of himself.
Transformer physiquement, apparemment, selon les témoignages, en des versions clones, on pourrait dire, de lui-même.
On the evening of April 21st, 1977, for a few brief seconds, Bill Bartlett saw a creature that he at first mistook for a dog. It was actually a humanoid being, barely a meter long. Its eyes were big and round and shining brightly. The creature was only visible for 5 or 6 seconds. Bill Bartlett was the first to spot this creature that the press soon dubbed the Dover Demon.
The creature itself seemed not to interact, except in one particular case, with any of the witnesses. The creature was seen standing on a stone wall in one case. The creature was seen approaching a young boy who was walking home, and the creature then scurried off into the woods. And in the other instance of the couple, they saw the creature very quickly on a bridge near the center of town, and it didn't seem to interact with them at all.
One night in September 1976, a resident of Laval, Quebec, was awakened by a loud sound coming from outside his home. He paused and waited for the sound to come again, but nothing happened. The next day, he was surprised to see footprints on the sidewalk. Up close, they looked like they had been made by horseshoes or some cloven-hoofed animal. They could be seen on both sides of the street. They came from nowhere and led nowhere. With the passing of the years, no explanation was ever given for these curious footprints. And no one ever came forward to admit that they had pulled this prank, if indeed that's what it was. Over time, cryptozoology has become a sort of no man's land, where all unidentified creatures get dumped whether they walk, crawl, or jump. While this melting pot has made cryptozoology one of the most fascinating fields of study in the vast universe of strange and inexplicable phenomena, it has also been a bone of contention among scientists. We're still far from the new science that Bernard Heuvelmans dreamt of 50 years ago. In his book, On the Track of Unknown Animals, Bernard Heuvelmans wrote, "Our world is saturated with mystery. It would seem that we are surrounded by question marks. Everything about us gives rise to questions, to which we know full well that there are, alas, no answers. At least no precise and definitive answers." More than a half century has passed since Heuvelmans wrote those lines. 50 years later, are we beginning to find the answers?
Cryptozoology has been raised as a category in an attempt to give some validity to many animals for which the evidence is perceived as insufficient. What these cryptozoologists don't realize is that cryptozoology itself is perceived as a form of pseudoscience by other scientists. For one thing, most cryptozoologists are not zoologists, they're amateurs, and that's not always a bad thing. But by lumping so many animals in this unnatural category, birds and reptiles and mammals all together, they're pretending to have expertise across a very broad range of zoological subjects. And most scientists simply won't accept that. They say, no, I couldn't, you know, be that well-versed to cover birds, mammals, reptiles. So how is this person who's not a zoologist making these claims? And so it's a little awkward. Cryptozoology is not quite as helpful a category as some of them perceive.
Authors John Keel and Brad Steiger have provided us with lists of all sorts of mysterious creatures that have made the headlines at some point or another. Up until now, we have only become acquainted with a few of them. But they're not the only dwellers of this incredible menagerie. There's also the Flatwoods Monster that was seen in West Virginia in 1952. And we mustn't forget the werewolves that have been haunting Wisconsin forests for years. A similar creature was also reportedly seen in Quebec in 1989 near Blue Sea Lake. Are these still a part of cryptozoology?
In cryptozoology, there's a divergence of opinion of what should be cryptozoological and what should be paranormal. And it really depends on who you are. My personal viewpoint is that certain creatures like Mothman and the Flatwoods Monster don't fit into the realm of cryptozoology. They're obviously something else. I personally wouldn't spend my time investigating these creatures, but obviously other people are welcome to do so, and I wouldn't impede them in any way from doing that, but I wouldn't call them cryptids at all.
The main problem with cryptozoology is that it has been left in the hands of amateurs, and the problem is that there is no money to finance this type of research. We tend to have an idealistic view of science. We imagine that researchers are out there looking for the truth. But in reality, the first job of a scientist is to find the money to do the research in the first place. And when they do raise the money they need to finance their research, well, the financial backers and organizations who support their research naturally expect to get a return on their investment. And in the end, it might be more worthwhile for them to support research into mold rather than research into Bigfoot. So we need to understand that as long as there is no financial financial support to begin research into bizarre animals, cryptids. I have the feeling that this type of research will continue to remain in the hands of amateurs for a long time to come.
Creatures like the Sasquatch no doubt belong to our animal kingdom. While incredible beings like the Mothman, the Dover Demon, and the Laval Devil seem to come straight out of a zoo from another dimension. Unless, of course, they come from a universe that is far more familiar, but just as unfathomable. A universe where anything can happen. Our imagination.